Welcome to this video, and if you're new here, hi, my name is Raquel. I'm 28 and I have a doggo. I'm also an avid artist and I love the Marvel Cinematic Universe, although I haven't watched Loki yet, so no spoilers in the comments. But my favorite characters are Loki and Iron Man, particularly Frost Iron is the ship that I have the most, you know, huzzah for. I do a lot of creative writing, a lot of photography, filming, graphic design, watercoloring, painting, coloring, bracelets, although I haven't in a while, but I have been meaning to, and other things to that effect. So anywho, this is a video that I thought about making. Like, this little series has just recently popped in my head, and I think I'm at a point where I'm okay to talk about it and can share my experiences and things to that effect. So if you are new to the series, you might notice from the title it somewhere along the lines of saying what to do when someone you love attempts to take their own life. So we are going to talk about suicide and suicide prevention and suicide prevention awareness, and September is Suicide Prevention Awareness Month. It is currently September 14th, 2021. And so we're going to talk a little bit about suicide attempts and just kind of hard stuff like that. No methods or anything to that effect. I do want to say, too, we'll talk about my boundaries. So my boundaries are these things. So I'm only an expert in my own lived experiences, so I'll only talk from I statements or sometimes we statements. But I am not a therapist. I'm not a crisis service. I'm not available between the times of 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time to 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and on the weekends during the day. So from like 8 to, probably from like 7 to like 5 p.m. So Eastern, EST. And then I also don't mention specific, like for eating disorders, don't mention specific weights or calories. Numbers and such. For suicide self-harm, don't mention specific methods or, you know, specific ways of hurting oneself or ideas of that or things to that effect. And those are pretty much my boundaries. Like, definitely don't mention specifics. And yeah, so I think that's kind of it for that, I think. I honestly feel like I'm forgetting something else, but I don't really remember. But those are essentially some of my boundaries. So just, again, not a therapist, not any of that, just someone with lived experiences. My channel is about recovery from various mental health conditions, and I'm doing very well in my recovery. I am 3.5 years out of the hospital setting. And also, suicide is a psychiatric emergency, so if you or someone you know is struggling with suicidal ideation, please call your local emergency crisis lines. You can also contact crisis lines and get the help that you need and deserve, and that's totally okay. Like, there's nothing wrong with going to a psych hospital. If that's what you need, that's what you need, and that's fine. And we'd rather you get help than be in a casket. So, yes. And then the other thing I want to say real quick is the story I'm going to talk about today and within this series is only from my perspective as someone close to someone else who attempted. And I'll share maybe a little bit here and there of like my own suicidality, like in the past. But primarily that's not what I'm going to talk about. I mean, we're going to talk about like suicide prevention and suicide attempts and such, and suicide attempt survivor versus suicide survivor, things like that. And grieving and the whole process of that. But this is also going to be just from what I'm doing as someone on the periphery of it. And I've never been in this situation really before. And I'm not going to mention names at all for the person involved in this story. I'm going to mention only they, them pronouns to protect their identity. And that's also not my story to tell. So that's why I'm not going to do it. And also, I'm not going to mention my relationship to this person. So, those are all the things I have to say, to kind of just disclaim everything from the get-go. As I mentioned, it is currently September 14th, and my hair is teal, so yes. Okay, so in this part, I'm going to talk about So I did the intro already, like, in a separate video, and it's gonna be, like, a little series. I don't know if I'm gonna make, a particular playlist just for this. I think I have a suicide prevention playlist already, but I haven't updated it in a long time. And, yeah. So, we're gonna talk about what happened. So, also, specifically, like, I'm not gonna mention specifics of things, and I'm not gonna mention, direct timelines. I'm gonna kind of fudge that detail a little bit, but this did take place in September, so this year, 2021. Alright, so what happened? Okay, so it was September, and this human that I love and care about, was going through some hard stuff, and they made an attempt on their life, and they were getting help, and then a few days later, they made a more severe attempt on their life, which means that they acted on suicidal ideation. And I knew something was off. I think it was, like, there was one day I was awake until, like, 1 a.m., and I thought about texting them, and I was like, oh, well, no, because I don't want to break my boundary that, like, you know, I don't text during the middle of the night or whatever, and so I didn't, but I wonder if maybe that would have changed something, you know, like, maybe that would have changed the timeline of events that was later to come. But I didn't hear from them, which I, you know, we text often and such, and I didn't hear from them one day, and I thought that was really strange, like, that was very unlike them. And then, you know, a few hours later that day, someone called me and said, hey, you know, so-and-so is in this situation. And I was like, what? Like, I was just, like, shocked. And so I found out that they weren't in a good space, and they were relatively safe at the moment. They were getting treatment, and over the next course of the few days, I slowly learned more information. It was a couple of days before I really kind of found out what was really going on. And so even when the first attempt happened, I would say the biggest thing, the way I reacted to it, was grieving. So for me, even though things hadn't got real bad yet. Hold on. Sorry, that wasn't like an emotional choke up. That was actually like I choked on my own spit. But, yeah. So, even though things hadn't got like super bad the first time, like, I definitely reacted to it like, yes, like, no, I didn't lose them, but I could have. And that was very scary. And so I started having feelings of, like, being scared and just concerned and worried and confused and trying to lie to myself to pretend, you know, it wasn't that, like, it wasn't intentional, it was accidental, like, it was instinctual kind of thing, like, it wasn't like that. So I was doing that, but then we were talking and everything in between then. And then when the second attempt happened, you know, and I wasn't hearing from them, and I was only hearing from other people, then it was like, oh shit, like, they're probably not in a good space. And I was like, that's not good. And, you know, that was really hard. And then hearing kind of more info about what was going on was also very hard. And, you know, it was definitely, I think the biggest way to describe it is, like, I just felt like, even though I didn't lose them, I was so close to losing them. And it's scary when it's like someone, like, losing someone to their own self. Like, their brain is, like, against them. And, like, that's a different kind of loss, in a sense. Even if the loss doesn't happen, the notion of the loss that could have happened, like, that is also really scary. And I really lost functioning for a few days. I I got through the first weekend at work pretty well, but I wasn't in it, you know, on Sunday. When I worked on Sunday, I wasn't in it, and I took this past weekend off and to kind of give myself some breathing room and to kind of figure out what I'm doing. I will mention in more specific videos all the sorts of stuff that I did, but I can say right now, like, I, you know, reached out to support networks. I tried to, like, you know, reach out to my friends and things. I reached out to Crisis Text Line. I like talked about the situation. I mentioned it in, like, support groups for OCD, and I talked to my parents about it. I coped healthily and made art and things, and actually something I'm going to get to in this next clip. And I'll talk more about all that specific stuff later too, but that's kind of just some of the sneak peek into some of the stuff I have been doing. There were a couple of days where I wasn't going to sleep until like 1, 2 a.m. There was a couple of days I stopped taking my meds. There was a couple of days I had self-harm urges. There were a couple of days I had intrusive thoughts. I had a lot of worries. I was thinking a lot about this person. I was trying to grasp at what I could do, and really there isn't that much that I can do at the moment. And this is all sort of what's going on right now. I was crying off and on. I was listening to a lot of music. I was doing all this stuff. And I think the biggest thing was, like, again, that, like, being confronted with, like, I don't know. I almost feel like I should have known something like this would happen, right? Like, I should have seen it coming or something, which I guess is probably, with suicide, is probably pretty accurate of a thing, you know, like, oh, what did I miss? Like, what could I have done? And part of it is, like, for me, I've almost struggled with, like, keeping my boundaries, and, like, I almost want to, like, put myself, like, you can reach out to me anytime, like, you can do all these things, but, like, that's not healthy, and that's not a good thing to do. In a sense, like, maybe it would help for a little bit, but it's not, you know, it's putting myself out and in a way that might not be healthy and may not help long term or even short term. So, you know, struggling with, like, keeping boundaries and continuing to live when it's such an uncertain circumstance. And, you know, I thought about, we had so many things we were gonna do, and what if that doesn't happen? And, you know, I don't want to lose them to their own brain. You know, why didn't they reach out to me? How could this happen? Why didn't they tell someone? Why? What happened? How did this happen? You know, I wrote, for a couple of days, I really couldn't verbalize anything, and then I wasn't sure what to say, what I could say, and that kind of thing, and struggling with that. Today was only the first day that I was able to be like, no, like, I could talk about it for my own, for what I'm doing and haven't been doing, like, have done and haven't done, and sort of talk about it in that sense. But there were a couple of days where I wasn't, like, I was like, I want to reach out for support online, but I don't know how to do it without giving away details. So that was isolating. You know, I figured out a way around it, after a couple of days or so. My attention span was absolutely shit. I couldn't finish watching even, like, a 5-minute video, like, and that, we all know YouTube is, like, something that I avoid with a lot. So even that was intense. I couldn't concentrate. I wanted to read books, but I couldn't concentrate. I couldn't justify being away from my phone. Like, it was a whole thing. So, like, yeah. I did, eventually I was able to write, in my journal, some poetry about the situation. I thought if I prepared myself for worst case scenario being death, that I could handle any other scenario, and it was really hard when my parents were kind of being like, you still have to do things, like you have to still get out of the house, you still have to go to appointments, you still have to go to work and do all these things, and it felt so insurmountable to do those things, and I was like, how can I can't, like, function, like, I don't know how to do that stuff. But even my dad, my dad had a conversation with me where he was saying, you know, like, you gotta still be strong, you gotta be the rock, like, for them, and you know, keep yourself going and all that jazz, and when he said that to me, it made me think, even though death isn't a one single event, like, it is a multiple event kind of thing, it made me more scared that if they do survive, how am I going to, like, manage those situations, those new endless possibilities of situations and scenarios and all these things that I wasn't thinking of when I was thinking worst case scenario, catastrophizing scenario. So that was even scary too. It was like, how do I be there for them? And I think a lot of that too is just knowing the person and having those conversations. I think another thing I want to mention is, like, something my therapist told me was, like, very much like, okay, first of all, you can't save someone else. Like, don't go into saving mode, because that is not realistic and not healthy. And then take care of yourself. You can't pour from an empty pitcher. And also just, like, have your boundaries, make sure that's there, and then don't go into, like, hard topics until that person is, like, ready. Like, if, you know, don't be like, why did you do this? How could you do this? Like, all that jazz, because that's not helpful. Like, you gotta wait until that person is healthier, before they can, and they're ready to have those conversations. So that was really helpful. That was helpful advice. I wrote notes, actually. If you guys would be interested in me sharing my therapy notes that I wrote in my journal about, you know, that and everything, feel free to let me know. And yeah, that's kind of like an inside scoop. I mean, this has been my life for the past couple of weeks, and it's not something I ever thought I'd have to deal with, but I guess at the same time, as someone living with mental health conditions and someone who has been suicidal and has known people who are suicidal and, you know, will continue to work with people who are suicidal, like, this is obviously something that maybe I should have anticipated happening in some manner, but I hadn't, and it kind of snuck up on me and was hard to deal with. And I think another thing I can mention too, one of my friends was saying that you know, if I was in your situation, I wouldn't be able to handle that. So that was helpful and validating in a way, because then it made me think, like, you know, my mom even said how, like, if a normal person was in this situation, like, that would be hard for them, and let alone the fact that you also live with similar things. So it's understandable if this is hard. So if you are a normal person out there dealing with this kind of potential loss or actual loss, like, that is huge, and you need to take care of yourself and everything. And that's okay, that's not selfish, that's self-preservation. And if you are someone who's struggling, know that a lot of people care about you. If there's no one right now who cares about you, I care about you. I don't want you to have to go through this pain and this horrible feeling of loneliness, thinking that this is the only way through, because it's not. And I know it's a lot easier to choose life and say to choose life, but ultimately, life is worth living, and you're wanted here, you're needed here. If there's not people in your life who want you right now, there will be people in your life who will one day. And, you know, what if today things got better? What if tomorrow things were better? What if 6 months from now things were better? You know, suicide ends the possibility of life ever getting better. And, you know, it's hard to think a lot about other people when you're struggling like that. But just know that if you hold on to hope and you believe in yourself, that if not, you know, knowing for yourself that it will get better, believe that other people telling you that it will get better is, like, truth. And don't listen to the crap inside your head, because your brain is lying to you. So that's kind of just what I have to say on that. I know this was a little long, but this was kind of a further overview of, like, what I'm going to be talking about in the series, but this is also just the context of stuff, too. So, hopefully this video was helpful in some way. I guess maybe even just, you know, facing these questions and these thoughts and these emotions, and how hard that is for someone who's normal and for someone who has lived experiences or, you know, you're struggling yourself, or you know someone who's struggling, or whatever that might be. As always, I'm going to leave resources in the description and other videos, playlists, or whatever I make for this series in the description. And then the next video I'm going to film tonight is just going to be a lighthearted kind of one. It's going to be a care package. So, yeah. That's pretty much it. Okay. Okay, so thank you for watching, and thank you for listening, and I hope that, you know, if you can't hold on to hope right now, I'll hold it out for you until you can take it yourself one day, and know that you're gonna get better, and it's gonna get better than this, and life isn't just pain, it's beauty, and wonder, and awe, and inspiration, and creativity. And yes, it is sometimes pain, and it's sometimes suffering, and it's sometimes horrible and awful and terrible, but it is both. Both can exist in the same space, not just one or the other. So, that's all I have to say. I'm gonna go film the second part, which is an additional part that's a little bit better, and maybe one more video after that. So, okay. Alright. Let me know in the comments what you thought, if anything was helpful, if anything maybe was, I could phrase a little bit better next time. Let me know. And if you made it this far in the video, put a cookie emoticon in the comments or something, okay? So, alright, I'm gonna go. As always, stay safe, take care, be well, much love and light to you, and I'll see you when I see you. Bye. I forgot that part in my last video.
I can see a lighthouse through the smoke. Everything is lost, I know. Underneath the roaring of the storm, I can hear the breaking of the dawn.